Hello guys and welcome to the class. Today we will talk about Python. Basically we're going to learn the basics of Python and then perform the same lab sheet task that we performed in the first class in the C++ refresher, but this time in Python. I'm sure by now you have already seen this document, which is the slides right here, and learn the theoretical basics. What is Python? How does it work, and the differences between it and C++. Now, of course, I suggest strongly that you go. Now, there is a new something unique in Python, which is indentation, and that will best to be seen when we do the hands-on. Now, this stuff, which is variables, commenting, you know, the rest of the stuff. You will notice the similarity between these and the same elements of C++. In other words, how do you capture an input and mathematical operators? These will look similar. Now, in the class, we remember we talked about two different types of listings or collections. You have the regular array list, which is you see right here, but this is also there is also a dictionary, which we will see later on. Now I leave the details of these operations for you to go through and the definitions of these operations on collections. And then, oh yeah, this is the dictionary. Basically, a dictionary essentially is not the language dictionary, but it's a special kind of listing. And it contains a listing of a variable name and then the value. Variable name and the value. Variable name and the value. Now, then, of course, other than collections, we have also conditional operations such as if, else, or case and switches. I think the case switch is maybe somewhere later down the slides. Then we have also the loops, while loop, for loops, as well as other loops operations. Then, of course, as well, functions. Now, the differences between Python and C++ is tremendous. Of course, syntax is simpler to work with, but more importantly is operational point of view as to why Python is different than C++. Okay, so let's get busy. So this is now the same question that we worked on last time, which is the adder, and now we're going to do it in Python. Minimum requirements exactly the same. Display a welcoming message, ask the user to input an integer, check if the integer is predefined limit, exactly the same things, but we're going to do it now in Python. Well, let's go to Genie then, and by the way, that C++ file is still here. I'll keep it for reference, but then I'm going to start fresh with a Python program. So the same thing, W3 Schools tutorial, and we're just going to go to the beginning, which is, I think, intro or get started. Does it get started? Yeah. Well, you can see now in the very beginning that how much simpler. Why is this not copying? Oh, my computer stuck or froze. Why essentially one? Oh, okay. My browser just froze on me. That's lovely. Well, I don't have to copy one line. So I just go, okay, it woke up. So intro or get started. Yeah, get started. Yeah, I'm too lazy to write one line, so I'm just gonna copy paste it. So I'm gonna go back to Genie and then print it, which is, if you remember in C++, we had to write a bunch of other things as well. Like we had to do include namespace and int main and then cout and so on and so forth, right? A bunch of lines. In Python, it's just this. We don't see any colors because I haven't saved the file, so let's do that right now. So save as usual, we're going to follow the convention. So this is going to be LS2, and then your ID number, but for this case, it's just 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Yeah, just a fake ID number, but for you, you have to put LS2 and then your ID number, in this case, ME or something like that. So I'm going to put SE, something like that, and then your number. Oh yeah, don't forget, of course, .python. Again, it's not a good practice to leave spaces in your file name or program or even use those the use, yeah, don't leave any spaces. Actually, even this dash right here is not a good practice, but we'll live with that for today. And here we go. So save, compile. No need to compile in Python, but we'll just do it for fun. And then execute, and hello world. Okay, let's get going then and finish the program. Let's close this. All right, so what is required from us? Okay, so welcome message, and then ask the user to input. So two print statements. Let's go there right now. Hi, or welcome to the program. And just like that, we have done the first part. And straight away, I'm going to ask the user to please key in the first number. Please enter the first integer. You know what? What was the message here? Right here. Hello and welcome to the program. Please define the limit. Oh yeah, we'll come to that later. But for now, enter the integer. And please enter the integer. And then I remember the way we did it was a bit simpler in the beginning. So enter the first integer. Less than 8. Let's just first hard code it and let's play with this successful and then execute. And straight away you will notice simplicity here. There's no brackets, so there's no semicolon, and there's no dash in at the end. You know, those guys in C, those things in the end, we didn't have to bother about those. There's no semicolon, there's no brackets. So it's much, much simpler and intuitive code. Python knows that at the end of this line, you would need to start afresh, so there's no need for you to do dash in. Okay, what else? Add this one. So ask the user to input and then capture the user value. Okay, we need to actually get input. So we're gonna come here and where is the input? User input. That's strings, casting numbers. User input, way down there. So user input, and then basically we had to put input. And actually there's input raw because you have different versions of Python. We can actually, even in Python 3.6, you can still use input raw if you want. There is differences between them, input raw. I'll leave that part for you to read. What is the difference between input and input raw? But then let's just go ahead and use input. So I'm gonna basically, now we could use a similar technique to what we did in C, like print statement and then capture the user input by itself. For example, we could just copy this line and come down to Genie and say right here, and just put A equal to input like this. I'm not sure if this is going to work actually. Compile and run successful. And yes, so 5. Oh yeah, I didn't put any confirmation to that. So make one more print statement. So copy. You have entered. You have entered. And how do you do that? Oh, we just simply do that. So okay. Issues with my mic here, just one second. Good to go. And then I'm gonna put plus. What's the plus sign we needed? plus a. Not sure if that's gonna work or not, so let's see. Successful. 5. Ooh, problem. Okay, so why we are getting this problem now, and see what we are trying to do here is take a string and then concatenate a number. See right here, a is an input. Notice straight away the differences between Python and C++. We didn't tell Python that this is an integer. You know what I mean? By the way, I want to do this again. Let's just run the program one more time. So I'm going to put, not an integer, I'm going to put a name. So Sammy, or, you know, Sammy. Still an error, because now the file string doesn't work. You see, Sammy is not defined, name Sammy. All right, let's just try now this, str. And this compile run 5. You have entered 5. Didn't leave a space here, so what's going on here is that, see, this is a string and this was a number. What I did was something called casting. So if I just do this right now, what's going on is that you're trying to concatenate or add a string to, or glue a string to a string. Well, this is a string. If you try to concatenate another item, it has to be also a string, but this is not a string. This is an integer or a number. So in this case, it won't work. So what I do something called casting. And in programming, casting means you are essentially whatever variable type that Python thought this was, I'm just gonna tell Python temporarily to set A as a string. Now pay attention to the fact that this does not change variable A. This only tells the compiler that, you know what, only for this line, you know, only for this singular line, consider A or assume A as a string. But then A itself is not changed. You know what I mean? So just for this line alone, think of it as a string. But this does not permanently change A into a string. It's simply only for this line alone. And we want to test that. We're going to do a mathematical operation. Of course, you cannot do math on a string. So if this was permanent, you cannot do math anymore. But later on, you can say A plus 5, for example. It will work, right? So try again. So put a 5. You have entered 5. Okay, so now I want to actually make my point again. So let's just say now print. You know what? Let's just say A equal to A plus 3. Or A plus 3. And I'm gonna put this again now. Now the value is, and what's gonna happen here, see, what I'm trying to say is that although we changed or we temporarily told the compiler to think of this as a string, A itself is still a number. So we're going to take the number, then add 3 to it, and then we're going to print it out again. And once again, we're going to do this here. So we are just sort of putting a package. We are pre-packaging the item into a string. So let's see. So 5. So, 4. Then it was originally 4. Then we add 3. Then it became 7. See? My point is, although this was here temporarily, we told the compiler to think of it as a string, it's still a mathematical number because we were able to do the math with it. Because if A was permanently a string, won't be able to add 3 to it. We're going to become a problem. So this is just for the to show only, but not to permanently change it. If you want to permanently change it into a string, there is a way for that, but we're not going to do that right now. Okay, so now we have done the first part, which is capture the user value and then check if it's within. Now, okay. See, this is a replica. We are repeating a program, but in C. So we don't have to go through the thinking process again. We know how we did it last time in C, so we just have to go and change the syntax into Python. So we go to Genie right now, and we just simply go, to C. And this is what we did last time. Basically, we used this. We had a while loop, and we check if the value is greater than or equal to the limit, and then we tell the user to do something here. So I'm gonna copy this code. Remember, this is C. Yeah? I'm copying it here just for fun so that I can then translate it. And then, how do you do it? I forgot. Yeah. So star, that work? No, not in, actually it does. Okay, so let's go back here and close it. No, star again and then here. Would that actually run? So let's see. Yeah, it's, I forgot how to make, how do you make multiple lines? Well, never mind. So I'm just going to put a singular line. I forgot how to make a block of code in Python. I'll have to Google it later on. Or maybe I think it doesn't exist in Python. But anyway, these are now comments. But then I need it here in order to basically replicate this, but in Python. So while A is less than or, you know what? Let's not do this. A is, we could definitely do it the old-fashioned way, which is greater than or equal to 8. That's what we hard code the value, right? And then what? And then we have to, this is the syntax for while loop. And then here we are now. Now we do the statement. So we're going to do is print. We're going to print this. Invalid entry must be less than, must be, there is a less here. Okay, probably missed it in a C++ program. Must be, integer must be less than, okay. So I'm gonna copy this whole thing, put it here, and don't forget those guys, less than 8. Now we're gonna ask him to re-enter. Is that right? So it's gonna, you know what? It's gonna copy this whole thing. No, not all this whole thing, just this only. We already have it, so it's gonna copy this line right here. Copy and then put it here. So please, no, there's no more pleases. So re-enter. Less than 8, okay, and then we have to update the value. So it's going to copy this line and put it here. And then here you go. Notice now a few things. First of all, the similarities. First of all, the while loop looks exactly the same structure, right? The same kind of logical way. Of course, there's another way of writing this in Python, but this works still. Notice the also now the way that the logic that we did in C is exactly the same logic we did in Python. It's just a different language. The same thing when you know how to speak or say something in English and then you know how to say it in another language. The same concept, the same thing you're saying, it's just a different language. Same thing we just did here. So, okay, differences now. The difference is, first of all, there is the semi double dot here, or the two dots here, and there is no brackets as usual in the block. There is no semicolons. Now, how do you then know that this part right here is part of this while loop? Well, as you can see, it's because of the indentation. The indentation is how Python defines a block of code. If there's no brackets, but then we're going to use the indentation. No, by because of these, all of these lines are indented exactly the same way. That's why the program knows that they are all in the same block. So then this is how it's going to work. Okay, then what's next? Oh, by the way, this way of capturing user input is the way we did it here. It's very much like C. Of course, there's another way of doing it. You can do it in one line, as you can see here. You get me? Essentially, define the variable, and then put input, and then right here is a statement. What we did was we put the print statement, the print statement, right? And then we capture the user input. We could have written this in one line. fact, let's just do that. So you can just say here, you can take this whole thing and put it here. So rather than wasting one line on the print statement, you can just say, basically, here's the message that we're going to give to the user to print the value, and then whatever user inputs is going to be captured by this input right here and then assigned to value A. That's essentially what this line does. And I'm going to just copy the whole thing here and put here re-enter. Let's run it. Yes, you see, notice now that suddenly the new line thingy doesn't work, right? And that's because we don't have a print statement. By right, this line here should be here, right? Like what happened earlier, right? And that's why, unfortunately, it doesn't work anymore. So how do you solve this? Well, you could always do the C++ way again. Or you could just return to the earlier version of this and use the print statement the same way we did it in C. So by doing this and running the program, now you can see this thing is right here. And then you can put 5. We are in that 5. Good to know. Now, what I was saying is that if you use this input right here, it won't actually have the new line because it's not part of the print. You will have to put this new line there. So go back here and then put an N just for fun to see whether this still works or not. Actually, this should still work just like in C. Just not sure if that's gonna run or not. So just see. Yeah, it does run. See, I put a new line right after the word integer right here. There's gonna be a new line, which that's what it means. So we could have actually done that here as well. So let's get back to that. X, put it here, and this guy cut and put it here. So that actually simplifies the code even still. And then take this whole line yet again and then do this and put here re-enter. I think this is the third time I do this, but it doesn't matter. Yep, works, 5, all right, good. So now let's try one more time. Run, put a 9, yep, enter a 9, put a 9, put a 9, nope, invalid entry, put an 8, invalid entry, until we put something less than 8, we're good to go. Okay, so we already tested it, and this works, so thank you very much. So this is the welcome program and this is the message. Okay, what else do you want? So now let's go to the next part of the program. Okay, and then we checked and captured the value and display to the user. We did. Okay, second number, repeat the same process. Okay, let's repeat the same process but for these. Notice, by the way, the simplicity of the program. So now, yeah, let's do that. So basically, copy. Now we have B here and B here and B here and B here. I think we should also, yeah, I think we should take this guy and put it here. Only print out the output after it has already been checked, not before. So this way, yep. So now we basically ensure that the user will always inputs the correct. I hate this when Python does these extra blocks here. Anyway, so save it. Yeah. Okay. So run and then enter. So 5. Yes. Okay, enter this. Oh, this is the second number. I have to change the text. So this is 9. It won't work. So 5 again. Yeah. So if I can change a few things. So print the first integer. Okay, first integer please. Okay so this is great. Now please re-enter. Please enter the second integer, and also less than 8 invalid integer, and then the second integer, and then second integer, and remove all this. So, yeah, okay. Let's run again. Into the first integer. 8 into first integer, integer 6, second integer, yeah, good to go. All right, so now what's next? Once the both are okay, then calculate the summation and display the summation, and then exit the program and goodbye, I think. All right, let's do that. So let's go back to Genie. Once these two are great, then C is equal to A plus B. Actually, there's no need for this line. You can just do this. The summation of STRA and STRB is and then we just put A plus B. There's no need even to declare a variable or a third variable. And yeah, so what's going to happen is that we are basically constructing the sentence, the summation of A and B. Notice, by the way, that we are doing a math here, and then we are taking the result and then we're putting it as a string and to show it. So it works. Compile. So 4, 5, yeah. Summation of 4 and 5 is 9. There's a little bit of spacing extra here. So, yeah. So just make sure that that looks cooler. 4 and 3 is 7. Okay. That works. And that actually is, once again, the minimum requirement of the project. Is that right? Yeah. Display the summation, exit a program with a goodbye, thank you, and just another print statement. And then make sure it's user-friendly with comments and all that stuff. Now, allow the user to set the values. Basically, we need to redo what we did here. Essentially, we make another print statement and tell the user to actually define the integer, define the limit. And then we can use that in our program. Let's do that right now. So this is now our Python. So before we come here, we'll have to actually do this. So I'm gonna straight away and do the individual. Basically, I'm gonna do, you know what, let's just do that. So limit, please set the limit for the limits, and that's it. Okay, so now we use the limit, and then we can straight away take this and we can put it here. And I'm just gonna come and do this. So plus limit and that's it. So let's see if that works before I can amend the others. So the limit now is going to be 6. Ooh. Oh yeah, I have to use this str. Okay, so str, and here we go. So now run. So set the limit 4. It has to be less than 4. So that works. Okay, I don't have to run the rest of the stuff, but I need to actually copy this whole thing and put it here. here, and then here. And that basically makes the program using our own very own limits. So compile, run. So set the limits. The limit is going to be 6. So after the first number has to be less than 6, so that's a 4. Okay, the first integer is 4, it has to be less than 6. I'm going to put a 7. No. What? I think I missed. Oh, yes. Do you know what happened? I think I missed one more limb, which is inside the while loop. Yeah, this was still at 8, so you have to make that. Make sure there's also a limb here, and there's also another limb here. So now that would work. So compile and run. So let the limit 6. Okay, it has to be, let's just make that work. And then this one has to be 7. It won't work. It won't work. It still won't work until we put something less than 6. So 4 plus 4 is equal to 8. Good to go. Now the last one right here, I want to actually do something. Yes, I want to actually come here and put an extra line. Online right here. Yeah, we just need an extra line. Okay, so now what else? So this was one bonus requirement, which is set the limit, right? Now set two limits, and then after that we use the end function. Let's do that. So now we go back to set individual limits. So I'm gonna go back here and put lim A. Set the limit for A. Okay, so this will be limit A, and right here is going to be limit A, and limit A, and limit A. Okay, and then we're going to do limit B, limit biscuit. Alright, so that was funny. That was actually not funny. So come here now to limit A, and then we, before we, yep, alright, so right here, here, say great. Now please set the limit, and then please enter the second integer. It has to be lim. This will be now lim B, and B, B, and B, and once again B here, and we're good to go. And the rest is the same. Set the limit for A, 6. So it has to be less than 6. So we put a 5. Set the limit for, oh shit, you changed that one. Okay, fine. 7. So it has to be less than 7. Okay. 5. So 5 was not okay. So which one I didn't set? This one. That will make it work. Now this is again done. Now what we're going to do is functions. Okay, so how do you write a function in Python? I forgot. So functions, oh, we have to define it. Okay, so go to Gini again, and doesn't matter where you put it, where you put the functions, kind of put it somewhere near the top. So I'm gonna welcome node, and then capture the first user input. What are you gonna do? I mean, you know what? I wanna define the function somewhere here. Define verify. Verify. Verify is already there. Verify. What did we call it last time? Validate number. You know what? Let's follow it. Follow the exactly the same name, but I'm gonna change something here. Validate number. Okay, so this is gonna be that. So what we did, what did you do last time in the validate? First of all, we put the while loop, and then we basically print out the statement, and then we return the value. So it has to return something. Okay, let's do exactly the same thing. So we did the while loop, which is right here. Copy. No. notice what happened to the indentation. So, okay, I'm just gonna repeat that. So notice after I copy pasted that the indentation has gone haywire, and that's gonna cause errors. We haven't seen that indentation error yet. I'm gonna actually show you that one later. But for now, the best way to deal with it is to do this. It's essentially back, and then enter, and then the indentation will be fixed automatically. This is the proper indentation. See, how do you know that? It's because everything inside here is already inside the function. So if you minimize this, you will know that it's already properly indented. Example, if it was like this and you close it, this guy is still outside. I mean, it should be inside. But because it's not indented properly, so that's why it didn't go in. But if I do this now, it will be good. Secondly, these two lines are inside this while loop, so they should go inside the while loop while we are correcting it. So what else we did over there? So we had this while loop when we do the corrections, and then we print out the statement, and then we actually return the number, which was, I think, this line right here, right? So after we did the print statement, we actually come here and indent one more time. So see, these two are on the same indentation, so they're on the same level, but this guy is inside here. What else after that? We have also return. Yes, now once again, the same principle that we did in C. We had two variables, so number and limit. So we're gonna do that here. So num and copy lim. And then right here, that will be num. And this will be limit. And let's remove this. Let's remove this. Invalid integer. The integer must be less than that. Re-enter the integer. There's no need for first and second now. And then the integer is. We're not gonna use a anymore because this is, we are local now. So we're gonna use also num. For number, num, and one more time here, and number, and we're gonna return the number as well. You know what I mean? So what are we gonna do? We're gonna actually follow the same idea that we did in C, where we essentially, after the user inputted, we're just gonna have to actually validate it. So sorry, not the same idea. We're just gonna come here now and say, okay, this is the user value, right? And then straight away we're gonna come here and then do this. A equal to validate. And as you can see, it's already right there. And then we're gonna actually have now to give it the two parameters, which is in this case, A and lim A. And we are good to go. And this should actually work. Now, this removes the need for these lines right here. So it's gonna remove this temporarily and put them here. So save and let's run this. Successful. Set the limit for A, so 6. Enter the first integer. That's 6. That's didn't work. Wait a minute. Oh yeah, okay. I want to actually purposely fail the thing. So let's go back here. So put a 6. So it has to be less than 6, so I'll put a 7. Okay, re-enter the integer, invalid integer, the integer. There's no more first, right? So 7 again, no. Okay, so now put a 4. The integer is, so which means our function actually worked. So now we can actually now come here and that's it. So these three lines will be like here. And now I can just copy this whole line and put it here. And that will be B equal to validate number B, and this will be B as well. And then we simply throw away this whole thing, and the program is over now. And then now we use the function, the validate function. Did you notice how lovely Python is now? So print the summation of A and B is this and that, and then basically finished. So yes, this, what you're looking at right now is exactly the same as this. That's exactly the same function. Maybe here I added a few more comment lines, but 1, 2, 3, and 4 extra lines, but then look at how beautiful this thing is. and we are good to go. In fact, we can even put these three lines in a function that would call the first function. Notice how, once again, these guys are actually repetitive. If you notice that this and this are actually repetitive, and we could actually write a function that will actually do the welcoming message itself. That actually could be interesting, and then we can even simplify the program even more. But I'll do that in a minute. So first, let's try that. So set the limit for A, 5, 4, okay, set the limit for B, 6, or 5 again, and 4, yeah, 4 and 4 is 8. It worked. So, okay, we're done already, but just want to do something for fun that I want to actually use a function for this. So how would that do? Now, the problem with this is I want to, you notice how this and this part right here and this part right here are actually repeated or similar. Not exactly the same, but they are similar. So you might want to think of, if you want to add a third number, for example, this will become a little bit tedious to do. And there is actually a way to automate this further by writing a function that will do this. So rather than writing this whole line, you will just call the function every time. And even for this, you can actually write a loop or a for function that will actually construct this depending on the number of variables. So let's say if it was 2 or 3 or 100, they will construct it. So, but I'll leave those things for you as an exercise for fun. But this is it. This is Python. We have done. This is the assignment, basically. The program works. And of course, other than this, you also have those extra other features, like to add validation, add a third number, and so on and so forth. So I hope this helped you to learn Python. And I wish you all the best into your training. And all the best in your next class.